in the audience than me, so I don't have any worries. They will take care if I make any mistake. So it's good to begin with beginning, and one can ask what is Galois cohomology. One can also ask what is group theory, but I will take the liberty of not bothering about that in this audience. So I will talk with talking very briefly about Galois cohomology. So I think in our group theory Sangam, homology of groups has been discussed quite a lot, right from very first lecture given by Deependra. And I think it also showed up in Vijay's lecture and maybe a few other lectures. And cohomology of not of groups, but perhaps cohomology of some certain type was there in Krishnendu's lecture. So these things have been discussed somewhat. Okay, so these are not new words completely for us, but I will try to give some very brief introduction to it. So to begin with, Galois cohomology is nothing but cohomology of Galois groups. And then the question is, what is then group cohomology? So group cohomology, basically, this is some sort of a derived functor of the fixed point functor. So to tell you precisely, suppose we have a group G acting on some abelian group by group automorphisms. So we know when a group G acts on a set X, this is precisely when you have a group homomorphism from the group G to the group of permutations on X. But if you have a group capital A, and we say that our group G is acting on it by group automorphisms, then we are not happy with the homomorphism from G to permutations on A. We would take this homomorphism from G to the group automorphisms of A. That's the way we will see this action. Okay, so we start with G acting on some abelian group A by automorphisms. Then there is a sequence of groups which will be called cohomology groups for every natural number, in fact, for every n bigger than or equal to 0. So every integer from 0 onwards, we get a very nice sequence of groups which are denoted by HN, G, comma A. The basic problem here is that when you have some exact sequence A to B to C to 0, starting with 0. So if you have a short exact sequence and if you have a group G operating on this exact sequence, that means the group is operating on each of the terms and the homomorphisms are, they commute with the group action, then the corresponding sequence for the fixed points need not remain exact. And then the question is whether you can extend it further by putting some groups, and that is what gives rise to this cohomology group. So these are derived groups in that sense. And if you want to know more about this, then Atiyah and Wall have a very nice article in this book edited by Cassels and Froelich. The article title is Cohomology of Groups. It's a very well-written article, and if you wanted to know where the group cohomology came even before Eilenberg and MacLane and Ekman defined it, then you should read this very nicely written article by Sridharan, which is published in Resonance in September 2005. So if you just search for these articles, just for this Sridharan, Beginnings of Group Cohomology, Resonance, then you will find it online. This article is available online. So this second article in particular talks about how cohomology was present earlier than the actual definition given by Eilenberg, MacLane, and so on. So these were there earlier by Hilbert, who had studied Hilbert, who proved Hilbert 90, and then Brouwer, Albert Haase, Brouwer, Noether, their theorem, and so on. So this was very much present before actually these groups were defined. Okay, so here we are taking our A to be an abelian group. This is important because this is something similar to what we do in module theory, that when our group G is acting on this abelian group, we can consider the action of the ring ZG, the integral group ring, on this abelian group A. And then A is a module over ZG, and then you can define these derived functors. But if A is not an abelian group, then it's not even a Z module. And so it's not a ZG module, it's not a module over the integral group ring. So you cannot talk about higher groups, higher cohomology groups. So, first of all, if it is not abelian, then this HNG comma A need not be groups. In fact, what we have for abelian group A is that these are all groups. These are all groups. So studying them becomes very easy. And when you have the short exact sequence of G modules A, B, C, and then you get the long exact sequence for the cohomology groups, it's a long exact sequence of groups. And you can talk about exactness because the identity element exists. You can talk about composition of two maps, kernel being equal to the co-kernel, and so on. Those things can be defined for groups. But in general, these are not groups. And you, in fact, we do not even have them for n bigger than 1. So we only have H naught G comma A, which is by definition the fixed point set A power G, and we have H1 G comma A. So these are the only two Galois cohomology sets. These are the only two group cohomology sets that we have. These are no more groups. However, one nice thing about them is that these are pointed sets. So A power G, this is a group because this is the set of fixed points under a group action. This happens to be a group. And in each H1 GA, there is a very distinguished element which works like identity element whenever H1 GA is a group. So if you have a short exact sequence of groups, which need not be abelian, but these are simply groups, and they admit G action, the sequence is admitting G action, which again means that you have G action on A, G action on B, G action on C, and the arrows are G homomorphisms, then we get a long exact sequence of pointed sets. So these are pointed sets, and therefore there is a distinguished element in each of these H1 GA, H1 GB, and H1 GC. And then you can talk about the sequence being exact because we will say that the set of elements here in H1 GB, which goes to the distinguished element in H1 GC, is the image of H1 GA. So the image of this is in some sense the kernel of the next map, where kernel by definition here means the set of elements which go to that distinguished element. That's the small change that we have to take in our attitude, and then this definition of long exact sequence goes very nicely, and you can do a lot more things with this long exact sequence. Maybe one could also add here that if you are A, which is a subgroup, normal subgroup of B, if this is a central subgroup of B, then A is in fact abelian being inside the center of B. So you have all the higher cohomology groups for A, and you can extend this sequence further by having H2 GA. So we will have one going to H naught A, H naught B, H naught C. Then there is this delta, which is the boundary homomorphism. And you have H1A, H1B, H1C. Then there is one more boundary homomorphism, connecting homomorphism, such that you have the next term, which is H2 GA. This may happen sometimes when A is the central element, A is the central subgroup, and this also has lots of applications. Okay, so we have only H naught and H1. However, these two are really very useful things to have. The fixed point sets are useful, but H1 in its own sense is a very useful object. So let's see what is the definition of H1. I have not even given the definition of H1 until now, but let me state the definition here. So to begin, let me reiterate that H1 is already quite useful. And what is H1? We take the set of all functions from G to A. These are not homomorphisms. These are all set theoretic functions which satisfy this particular definition. So this definition says that when you have phi acting on G1, G2, the product G1, G2, this has to be equal to phi G1 into G1 acting on phi G2. This phi G2 is an element in capital A. Capital A has a G action. So G1 acting on phi G2 makes sense. That's an element again in capital A. Phi G1 is an element in capital A. and we are demand that the image of G1, G2 be equal to product of these two elements in A. So you consider all such functions from G to A, and we put an equivalence relation among them on that set, where we declare that phi is equivalent to every such phi A, where phi A is modifying the function phi by putting an A inverse before and GA at the end, or some A in G. You choose your A in G and you multiply to phi G by A inverse before and by GA afterwards, and you get a new function from G to A. One can check that this also satisfies the earlier condition. And among this, so with this, this is an equivalence relation, and the equivalence classes under this equivalence relation is defined to be H1 GA. This definition alone, it may look like a slightly non-trivial, meaning, you know, very non-natural definition, but definition has lots of importance. For instance, if your G happens to act trivially, then G phi G2, G1 phi G2 here will simply be phi G2, because there is no G1 action now. And then the functions from G to A satisfying the definition become the set of all homomorphisms from capital G to capital A. The numerator is the set of all homomorphisms. What is the equivalence relation then? Once again, there is no GA because the action is trivial, remember. So you simply get phi A of G is A inverse phi G A. So you have two functions whose images are pointwise conjugate, whose images are conjugate by a single element A. For every G, you have phi G and phi A G are conjugate by A. This is the equivalence relation. Okay, so under this equivalence relation, the set of homomorphisms gives you some equivalence class, and that is our H1 when the group G acts trivially on capital A. And this is also the reason that the set of that the numerator is sometimes called crossed homomorphisms. These are homomorphisms twisted by the G action in a bit. Okay, so this is our definition of H1. Capital G, capital A, and now Galois enters the picture. We see Galois ka jalwa here. If you have a finite Galois extension, capital K over small k, and suppose you have some algebraic group defined over small k. So E is your algebraic group. I have put the symbol E here just to, you know, also tell you that E is even allowed to be a projective group. You can take it even to be an elliptic curve if you want. Okay, so if you have a finite Galois extension, capital K over small k, and you take an algebraic group defined over small k, then on the capital K rational points, so this is a group which is defined over our base field, and you have a finite extension which is Galois extension, then on the capital K points of capital E, the Galois group will operate. Okay, and so you have capital E over K, which is a group, and Galois group operates on it, and therefore by the above definition we have the H1 Galois capital K over small k E capital K. Every finite Galois extension will give this set, pointed set, H1 Galois capital K over small k capital E of capital K. And once we have this, we define this absolute H1 by the following definition, that H1 KE is the projective limit, H1 Galois capital K over small k capital E over capital K, and take the limit. I think this is the direct limit. The group, Galois group, is a projective limit, and this may happen to be a direct limit. So all these finite H1s, when their limit is taken, we get the absolute H1. And this is called the first Galois cohomology set of capital E over small k. So what we have here is that we have the absolute Galois group which operates through its finite quotients on this capital E over capital K. And whenever you want to see the action of the absolute Galois group on any point in E K bar, you will take a Galois extension where that point is contained, and then you consider the Galois group action over that finite Galois extension. So that is how this absolute H1 is understood. Okay, so let's see some examples of how these Galois cohomology sets behave. So first of all, these are some very natural examples of groups. I have not given the examples of projective groups here, but these are all linear algebraic groups. If you take this group GA, which by definition over any extension, the capital K rational points are simply the points of capital K. So this is called the additive group GA. Then normal basis theorem will tell you that all HI are zero. Here GA is an abelian group. Therefore, all higher HI are also defined. And this, I should have said that this is for I bigger than 1, bigger than or equal to 1. So for I bigger than or equal to 1, all the higher Galois cohomology groups of GA are zero. That same thing also happens to be true for GLN. But here, because now GLN is not necessarily abelian, we will put that it's equal to 1. Sometimes people also write it equal to 0, but we will stick with the notation 1. So this H1K GLN, that also happens to be 1. And we will see later that there is a connection of this statement with some very basic statement in linear algebra. In fact, for n equal to 1, if you look at H1K GL1, that being 1 is called the Hilbert 90 theorem, which Hilbert had proved when he wrote his book on number theory. And this came before the Eilenberg-Maclelland definition of group cohomology came before. This was before that. And this is also mentioned in Sridharan's article. This second next example is also there in Sridharan's article. So the H2, I cannot highlight this for some reason. So H2K GL1, the second cohomology group. Now GL1 is again abelian. So you can talk about higher cohomology groups of GL1. And H2K GL1, this is isomorphic to the Brouwer group of small k. So Brouwer group can be defined using this notion of central simple algebra and some equivalence put on them. And this Brouwer group is isomorphic to the H2 of GL1. If you take the orthogonal groups, so you fix a form, non-degenerate quadratic form Q over K, and take H1 of K OQ. OQ is the set of all orthogonal matrices or orthogonal operators on that quadratic space for Q. If you take its first Galois cohomology set, this is in bijection with the isomorphism classes of non-degenerate quadratic spaces over K of that fixed dimension. And if instead of O, if you look at SO, you are going to get the isomorphism classes of non-degenerate quadratic spaces of that given dimension of any given discriminant. So once you are looking at some discriminant, fix the discriminant, and you are looking at quadratic spaces which are non-degenerate of a fixed dimension, their isomorphism classes over small k. Remember, these are the isomorphism classes over small k. If you go to algebraic closure, then any two such quadratic spaces which are of the same dimension, they are going to be isomorphic. But over small k, they need not be isomorphic. And the different isomorphism classes are captured by this set H1, K, O, Q. And finally, we also have that H1K of the symplectic group is trivial. So we see that H1 of various groups gives us a lot of information about various algebraic objects. So there is a general statement with this theme, and this is the general statement. This says that we start with some algebraic object defined over K. So I will let this notion of algebraic object be slightly vague. It can be a central simple algebra, it can be an algebraic group, and it can be anything. You may look at a group and then you want to look at some certain subset in it. And suppose we define by this math cal F, X capital K over small k this is the set of all similar objects. So the objects Y, these are similar to the object X. If you are looking at X to be an algebraic group, then you will take Y also to be algebraic groups. If you are looking at X to be quadratic forms, Y are also quadratic forms. Okay, so you collect all similar objects which are defined over K and which have the property that over this Galois extension capital K, Y happens to be isomorphic to capital X. And on this set, you put the isomorphism equivalence over small k. So what you are doing is that you are looking at k isomorphism classes of what are called as forms of X from capital K to small k. These objects which become isomorphic to X over capital K, these are called forms of X. So over an extension, they may look like X, but below they may look differently. You know, for instance, you may have a quaternion algebra, which is a division algebra, and you may have a 2x2 matrix algebra, and over some quadratic extension, they become isomorphic because your quaternion algebra acquires a non-zero zero divisor. And once you have a zero divisor, which is non-zero, then your quaternion algebra will no longer remain division. So it will become isomorphic to the 2x2 matrix algebra. Okay, so the forms over that particular degree to extension of matrix algebra, 2x2 matrix algebra, are certain quaternion algebra. But not just that, we are not looking at the set of all such forms. We are going to go modulo isomorphism over small k. If they are already isomorphic over small k, then we would like to consider only one from that basket. That's what we are going to do. So this Fx capital K over small k is the set of K isomorphism classes or forms of capital X defined over small k, but these are capital K forms. So they are isomorphic to capital X over capital K. And this basic theorem, I don't quite know who proved this, but it may be due to Andre Weil, perhaps. This theorem says that if you consider this set, the H1 Galois of this finite extension, and the group for U is the automorphism group of capital X. Okay, this need not always be an algebraic group. It may sometimes be like GL and Z, but even that is okay because it's a group for us. So you have H1 Galois capital K over small k to aught X over K. This first Galois cohomology set is in bijective correspondence with the set of small k forms of capital X over capital K. This is the main statement, and the earlier examples that we have seen of the orthogonal group and special orthogonal groups, these are special cases of this result. And I was saying that the example H1K GLN equal to 1 is connected to a basic statement in linear algebra because your GLN is the automorphism group of the n-dimensional vector space. And what this statement says is that if you take any two n-dimensional vector spaces over small k, then these are already isomorphic over small k. A very sophisticated way to prove one very simple statement. But this is how H1 classifies objects over small k, and we are going to use this. It does not only classify objects using the automorphisms, but there are various ways. Instead of automorphism, you can have lots of other groups here, and using those groups, we can classify various kinds of objects. So the problem would be to translate your problem into a suitable first Galois cohomology set, and then use the rich theory of Galois cohomology to solve your problem. This is where these are the basic two steps in the theory, in the way of applying Galois cohomology in group theory. But before we go further, here are some very interesting things, and I should mention these because there is a very important Indian contribution here. So there is this Hassan-Minkowski theorem. What does Hassan-Minkowski theorem say? Hassan-Minkowski theorem says that if you have two non-degenerate quadratic forms which are isomorphic over each completion. So we start with a global field K, and there are various completions of this K. We will call them KV. And if I have a form Q defined over K, I can also see the form Q defined over these KVs. But to have piece of notation, we will call that form defined over QV over KV to be the form QV. All right. Then the Hasse-Minkowski theorem says, first of all, that if two forms are isomorphic over K, this will definitely imply that they are isomorphic over all the places, over all completions. If they are isomorphic here, over any extension, they will remain isomorphic. But the converse also holds, which is that if they are isomorphic over all those places, then they are already isomorphic below. And which is interpreted using Galois cohomology by saying that H1KOQ to product H1KVOQV, this map is injective. This is a map of Galois cohomology sets. And this is injective. That means it's clear what one means by having a function to be injective. We don't have to explain it in terms of kernel. Okay. And once you have it for O, which is a group, algebraic group, one can ask whether this statement holds in general. And there was this conjecture, which was called Hasse principle, which is that if you have a group G, which is semi-simple and simply connected over a number field K, then this natural map H1KG to product H1KVGV is injective. This was a very celebrated conjecture and it was proved by proving various cases. It immediately boils down to solving for simple groups, the simple groups which are classified by Dynkin diagrams and so on. And Kneser began, and then Harder came along and proved, the conjecture was proved case by case. And ultimately, the last case was the case of EAT, which was proved by Chernozov around 1989. So this is how this conjecture was settled. But one very small consequence, one very important consequence is that if your K is what is called a totally imaginary number field. So if your K has no real places, then for a semi-simple, simply connected G, H1KG is 1. This follows from the previous Hasse principle. So Jean-Pierre Serre conjectured that this particular statement that H1KG is trivial holds for all fields of cohomological dimension 2. And Eva Bayer and R. Parimala proved this conjecture for all classical groups. So they have two papers. One is I don't remember the years, but one in Inventiones and the other in the Annals. So there is one slight modification of this theorem by Kolyotalin. And these two proved both these conjectures, the conjecture of Serre and then the conjecture of Kolyotalin. And these conjectures are proved for all classical groups. So this is a very important Indian contribution in this theory of Galois cohomology for classical groups. Okay. Now we go towards how one can apply Galois theory, Galois cohomology in our group theory, the group theory of our interest. So let me again begin with some basic things. Suppose I have an algebraic group defined over K, and let capital A be a K subgroup of G. That means it's a subgroup of G and it's also defined over small k. That is what we mean by saying that it's a K subgroup. What I would now like to do is to classify conjugacy classes of capital A, but not just over small k, but over all extensions. And if I have a finite Galois extension capital K over small k, I would like to compute the forms under conjugacy of this subgroup capital A. So let me explain by what I mean by this statement. Suppose I have another K subgroup capital B with the property that B becomes conjugate to capital A over an extension. So A and B are subgroups of capital G over small k. There they need not be conjugate. But over an extension, you may get an element in your capital G or capital K such that now these two subgroups are conjugate. Okay, I would like to find all such capital B which are defined over K, which become conjugate to capital A over capital K. This is what I want to find. So what we do is the following thing. You start with your Galois group capital K over small k, apply this Galois automorphism to this equation. Now capital B is defined over small k, capital A is defined over small k. So Galois group acts on these two. Galois group will take capital B to capital B. It will not fix every element, but it will take as a subset. Capital B is going to be taken to capital B. Capital A will be taken to capital A. So sigma applied to capital B is capital B. So we get capital B here. And here we are going to get capital B, which is sigma of capital B, which is sigma G, sigma A, sigma G inverse, which then becomes sigma G, capital A, sigma G inverse. We are only applying this Galois automorphism sigma to this particular set. We are applying sigma here, and this is what we get. B equal to sigma G, A, sigma G inverse. So instead of looking at both these equations, we just consider the right-hand sides of these equations. And we get G, A, G inverse equal to sigma G, A, sigma G inverse, which tells us that G inverse sigma G is an element in the centralizer of capital A. It centralizes capital A. And it's an element which is lying over capital K, because G is over capital K. Sigma is an element in the Galois group.
Should it not be normalizing?
Yeah, you're right. Thanks a lot. Is it Pralay?
Yeah.
Sorry. I did not get who corrected it. So yeah, thanks a lot.
This is Pralay.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. You are very much correct. Yeah. For a single element, it would be the centralizer, but for a group, it is the normalizer. So now I cannot make these corrections, but when I submit the slides for putting on the web page, I will change it to normalizer. You are very much correct. This has to be the normalizer.
No, but you have not defined what is ZGA. You can just say ZGA denotes normalizer of A.
Yeah. Thanks, Manish. Yeah, but that's a mistake anyway that I made. So this should have been the normalizer. Yeah. Okay, so what we now get is that we consider this map defined on the... So this is a function which takes input the Galois automorphisms, and we get an element in the normalizer of A, which here we denote by ZGA. Okay, so this function phi sigma equal to G inverse sigma G, it very easily satisfies the following condition, which is that phi of sigma 1 sigma 2 is G inverse sigma 1 sigma 2 G, but you can adjust the sigma 1 G and sigma 1 G inverse and get that in this square bracket here, we get phi 1 of G, and this is sigma 1 acting on, sorry, this is phi of sigma 1, and this is sigma 1 acting on phi sigma 2. So we get it's a cocycle, it's an element in that numerator of H1 that we had defined, it's a crossed homomorphism. Phi sigma 1 sigma 2 is phi sigma 1 into sigma 1 acting on phi sigma 2. That's the thing we get. So once you get some element in the normal, in the numerator, we can consider its equivalence class. You can consider the whole equivalence class modulo the equivalence relation that we have defined. And so we get an element in the first cohomology set of the normalizer of capital A. Okay, so we have the normalizer of capital A, and we take its first Galois cohomology set, and this capital B, which was a subgroup defined over small k, which became conjugate to capital A over capital K, gave rise to one element in H1 of the normalizer. Now there are many things happening here. First of all, instead of choosing this G, you may choose a different element which conjugates capital A to capital B, and then your whole definition will change, your phi of sigma will change, because you will have a different G coming there. But one can check that the ultimate equivalence class in H1 that we get is the same. So you will get a different element in the numerator, you will get a different crossed homomorphism, but the H1 that corresponds to both of these crossed homomorphisms is the same. And moreover, in fact, you may change your B by K conjugacy class. You may take another subgroup of G, which is conjugate to B over small k. You may even do that. That will also give rise to the same element in H1. So the K conjugacy class of capital B corresponds to an element in H1, and in fact, this element in H1 is going to determine that K conjugacy class back. So note here that we do not have the complete statement in the basic theorem. We have the complete statement that H1 of this automorphism group is in bijective correspondence with some certain forms, set of forms. We don't have that. We only have it for a subset. What we do is that you start with a K conjugacy class of B. You get an element in H1 by our method. That element in H1 determines your conjugacy class back. So if by some way you are able to determine all elements in H1, which can come by that following way, then you know that you have a control on all such forms under conjugacy of the subgroup capital E. Okay, so we will apply this theory to some very particular type of subgroups. And even here I made this mistake. That's very stupid of me. I should have considered here normalizer. So we apply the previous results to a special type of subgroups of G, the maximal tori. So what we do is that we take a split reductive group G over small k. By split we mean that it has a maximal torus which is split. That means it is isomorphic to product of GL1s over small k itself. And we consider this exact sequence. This exact sequence should have told me that it's the normalizer, that you have one going to T, going to ZT, going to the Weyl group to one. This is our short exact sequence, and Galois group operates on all these things. So the absolute Galois cohomology sets will give us this part of the sequence. You have H1KT, remember T being split is a finite product of GL1s, but H1K GL1 is 0, that is Hilbert 90, and therefore H1KT is 0. So we have 0 to H1K normalizer of T to H1KW. And further, W acts on the torus being the normalizer upon T. Normalizer T upon T. So it has an action on torus. Therefore, W embeds inside the complete automorphism group of the torus. And that automorphism group, because T is split, we have that the automorphism group is GLNZ. So there is a natural map from W to GLNZ, where you are simply sending each element of W to its corresponding action on capital T, the corresponding automorphism on capital T. Okay, so this is the way we continue the sequence. I am not saying that it's an exact sequence at this level. All I am saying is that for my convenience, I am looking at the further map from H1KW to H1KGLNZ. Okay, what we now notice is that the action, Galois action on W and Galois action on GLNZ, these are trivial because your torus is split. So all these elements of capital W are defined over small k. All automorphisms of torus are defined over small k. Therefore, the Galois group of the absolute Galois group will act trivially. So these H1KW and H1KGLNZ, if you remember from our earlier discussion, these will correspond to homomorphisms. Now there is no crossed homomorphism. There is no twisting of homomorphism. These are simply homomorphisms whose images are conjugate. So these are homomorphisms modulo an equivalence relation, and the equivalence relation says that the images are conjugate. Okay, so what we do is that once you start from the, so this is the normalizer, and normalizer will give information about forms of capital T under conjugation. So H1K normalizer is going to give us information about forms of capital T, and each form of capital T will correspond to some certain element in H1KW and some certain element in H1KGLNZ. And these are, if you take the images of those elements, remember once again that action is trivial. So we simply have homomorphisms from the Galois group to these groups. And we are therefore looking at some certain subgroups of capital W sitting inside GLNZ. And we get information about some certain conjugacy classes of these elements of W in GLNZ. This is what we are going to get. So I studied this question of maximal tori determining the algebraic groups. So the question was as follows, that we begin with two split semi-simple groups of adjoint type defined over some certain specific groups. And we are assuming that maximal tori are up to isomorphism the same in these two groups. That means you have two groups G1 and G2, and we say that whenever there is a maximal torus T1 in G1, then in G2 there is a maximal torus T2 which is isomorphic to T1. And similarly, when you start with a maximal torus in G2, then there is a maximal torus in G1 which is isomorphic to the maximal torus in G2. So these two groups have the same set of maximal tori up to isomorphism. That's what we are starting with. Using this, we apply the previous analysis. Now note that just like we had obtained the information about centralizers, the normalizer giving information about conjugacy classes, GLNZ, this is the set of automorphisms of the torus. This is going to give us information about the isomorphism classes of tori. Here we have information about conjugacy classes of tori in G and information about abstract isomorphism classes of tori. And to combine these, because we are looking at tori inside these two groups, so we have to look at the corresponding while groups. So instead of looking at all elements in H1K GLNZ, we will have to look at, if there are two groups G1 and G2, they will have two while groups W1 and W2. And we will look at H1K W1 sitting inside H1K GLN and H1K W2 also sitting inside H1K GLN. And if these two images corresponding to some maximal tori in G1 and G2, if they, those tori are conjugate, then these two images will be, if those two tori are isomorphic, then these two images will be conjugate inside this big group GLNZ. That's the analysis that we have here. So it tells us that whenever you start with any element in the first while group, it has a conjugate in GLNZ sitting in the other while group. And similarly, when you start with some element in the other while group, it has a conjugate in GLNZ which is sitting in the first while group. So these two while groups have the same set of elements up to conjugacy in GLNZ. Using this, and of course, we should note here that the embeddings of the while groups are given in a natural way. These are given not any embeddings. Only then we have the following result, that the while groups themselves are isomorphic as abstract groups. And once while groups are isomorphic, since you have taken your groups to be of adjoint type, you can determine your algebraic groups themselves, except that the algebraic groups of the type Bn, SO2n+1, and the algebraic groups of the type Cn, the symplectic groups sp2n, have the same while groups. So you may have your groups, two groups where there might be a change of factors of SO2n+1 with the factor of type sp2n, but other than that, the groups themselves are isomorphic over small k. This was the result which was proved long time back, and then about 2-3 years back, when Anup visited me, he asked me one very interesting question on Z classes, and that allowed me to use Galois cohomology once again. So let me explain what we mean by Z classes. So this is a slightly different theme. We start with a group G and take X and Y, two elements in the group G. We say that X and Y are Z equivalent if their centralizers in G are conjugate. So clearly, if you have two elements which are conjugate already, then we know that their centralizers are conjugate. But this is a slightly weaker notion that we are looking at the centralizers and we are asking whether the centralizers are conjugate. So why are we looking at this different notion? This is because there is a notion of equivalence of orbits whenever a group G is acting on a set. And as far as the equivalence of orbits goes, the notion of these two X and Y, the orbits generated by them will be equivalent under the G action. As a G set, the orbits of X and Y are equivalent. If you have X and Y to be conjugate elements, then the under the conjugacy action, you get the same orbit. But there could be another conjugacy class, which might be equivalent to your conjugacy class under the G action. That means there could be a function from this orbit to this orbit, such that it commutes with the G action. And this is precisely when the elements X and Y have conjugate centralizers. So this notion is a very natural notion. And it comes from looking at the equivalence of orbits when G is acting on itself by conjugation. So a Z equivalence class is going to be union of certain conjugacy classes, because whenever some element is equivalent to another element and you take the conjugacy classes here, they are also going to be equivalent to each other. Any two conjugate elements are Z equivalent, and this is an equivalence class. So of course, a Z equivalence class will contain these conjugacy classes. This is a very old notion, but in India, it was brought by Professor Ravi Kulkarni, and his students studied this thing quite a lot, as well as the school of Manish Thakur and the further elements. So Anupam and Anirban, who are Manish's students, and Sushil, who is Anupam's student, they have worked a lot on Z classes in several groups. And what was of our interest is this particular result proved by Krishnendu and Ravi Kulkarni, which is that if you look at some certain fields, then the number of Z classes in classical groups over those fields was finite. They did a lot of computations and they found out that some certain the number of Z classes in classical groups over certain fields was finite. What was these certain fields? So they said that if your field has the property that for any degree, there are only finitely many extensions of that particular degree. If this is satisfied, then their computations showed that the number of Z classes was finite. And it's a very good thing to have a number of Z classes to be finite. It would mean that up to equivalence, there are only finitely many G sets when G is acting on itself by conjugation. And Anupam came to visit me and he asked me whether we can think about this question over general reductive group. And we found out there is this very nice book on galvacohomology by Sayre, which has this definition, which was introduced by Borel and Sayre initially. So we call a perfect field K to be a field of type F if there are only finitely many extensions of capital F of any fixed degree N. So these are the same fields that Krishnendu and Ravi Kulkarni were thinking about. Okay, so what are the examples of these fields? The examples of these fields include algebraically closed fields because they have no extension at all, real field, perhaps also real closed fields, local fields, because local fields also have this property that over any for any number, there are only finitely many extensions of that degree. Whereas number fields are not fields of type F. In fact, you would know that even for rational numbers, there are infinitely many quadratic extensions which are not isomorphic to each other. So we wanted to investigate if the previous result of Gangopadhyay and Kulkarni, the GK result, is true for such fields for a general reductive group. And our attempt was to use galvacohomology. That's the thing that came to our mind immediately. And why can we use galvacohomology? Because there is a very nice theorem of Steinberg and others that if you take a reductive group over an algebraically closed field of any characteristic, then the number of Z classes there is finite. In fact, Steinberg did a lot of this work, but the number of unipotent classes was remaining, especially over bad characteristics. and that was later completed by Lustig and others. So this is a very major result which proves that if you are working over an algebraically closed field of any characteristic and you take a reductive group G, the number of Z classes is finite. And we are going to use H1 and this result of Steinberg and others. But so our strategy was as follows, that we have the Z class below, you extend by base change and you get the Z class above. There are finitely many Z classes above. And use H1 to say that only finitely many Z classes will go to one particular Z class. But there was one very basic difficulty in this, which was that there was no map from the Z classes below to Z classes above. Because you may have two elements. So I have again stated this statement in incorrect way. You may have two elements which are Z equivalent below, but they may not be Z equivalent over K bar. It's exactly the other way of what I have typed here. So you can have two elements. What may happen is that over a base field, which might be very small, your G over K may not have enough elements. And so your G over K might in fact be an abelian group, whereas it may become non-abelian if you go to an extension. If the group is abelian, then any two centralizers will match with the whole group defined over small k, and so any two elements of this group are going to be Z equivalent. But when you go to an extension, your group becomes non-abelian and these two elements which were happily becoming Z equivalent to each other may now decide to not be Z equivalent to each other. This happens. For instance, you may take the upper triangular matrices of 2x2 over field of order 2. That's just an abelian group. And therefore, identity element is equivalent, Z equivalent to the non-trivial upper triangular matrix. But if you go to a sufficiently big extension, the identity element will have the same centralizer, the whole group. Whereas the upper triangular matrix will now have a smaller centralizer. So these two elements, which were happily Z equivalent over below, are no longer Z equivalent. So this set of, we don't have a well-defined function from the set of Z classes below to the set of Z classes above. So what we need to do is to split our proof in two cases. We look at finite field, K being a finite field and K being an infinite field. If your field is finite, of course, we know that everything connected to finite field is a finite set. So the number of Z classes is going to be finite. So for finite fields, we are done. We keep them away. Then we look at infinite fields. And here Grothendieck's theorem tells us that over an infinite field, if you have a linear algebraic group, then the set of K rational points is dense in the set of K bar rational points. Therefore, if you had two elements which are Z equivalent below, they will remain Z equivalent above. So the map is well defined for infinite fields. It is not well defined for finite fields, but we don't care about them because that result we know is true. So we will work only over infinite fields, and over there we use H1 and this finiteness. So this is again another important result which Borel and Sayre had proved, that if you have a field K of type F and you have any linear algebraic group G defined over small k, then this first homology set is finite. This was one very basic result which they had proved while investigating these fields. So what we know is that the set of Z classes over K bar is finite. The fiber of the base change from K to K bar, that is finite, and therefore the set over K is a finite set. So this is our theorem, which was published last year, that this is work with Anupam. If G is a reductive group defined over a field small k of type F, then the number of Z classes in GK is finite. So this is very strongly generalizing the Krishnendu and Ravi Kulkarni's work. And moreover, it's not a computational proof. Although computational proof is the one which gave us in motivation to think about this question. So now before I close this, it would be interesting to tell something about some more recent work. So there is some ongoing work and I have almost proved something, but it's not quite complete. So let me take 1 or 2 minutes to explain this. Suppose we look at conjugacy classes in GLNFQ. Then what we observe is that the discretion of Z classes does not depend on the base field Q. For instance, if you are looking at only GL2 FQ, how are the conjugacy classes in GL2 are defined? How are they described? You have these scalar matrices whose centralizers are all equal to the whole group. So that's a single Z class. Then you have diagonal matrices which are not scalar. So you have 2x2 elements. You have the diagonal two entries which are distinct. And these may not always be conjugate. We will need the entries to be the same to have the same conjugacy class. But it's the same Z class because the centralizer is the full two-dimensional torus. And then you have some, there is a degree two extension. It's a unique degree two extension that the well restriction of the scalars will give you a torus in GL2FQ. And that is again one Z class. And then you have the upper triangular matrices. So this description of Z classes, the number of Z classes does not depend on what Q you are looking at. So is it true that whenever I have a finite reductive group and I take the number of Z classes in this finite reductive group, it is independent of the base field? Do we always have such a result? And yes, but for large Q. And the problem, so more precisely, if you have a group G, which is defined over a finite field FQ, then the number of Z classes in G FQ power N is going to be independent for large N. Once you go beyond a certain Q power N, then the number is going to be same. And I will also tell you why we have to go to some extension. That is because some certain centralizers may not show up below. You know, if you are looking at the diagonal torus inside GLN, then to have the diagonal torus as a centralizer of some element, you need the diagonal matrix with sufficiently many distinct entries. And your base field may not contain those many different entries. For instance, you may be working over F2, and then the only element in the split torus is the identity matrix. And it will not give the split torus as the centralizer. So to show every element, to have every centralizer, such subgroup appear as a centralizer, you will have to go to some extension. But once you get all of these, then above that, the number remains the same. So with this, I think I have said everything that I wanted to say. Thank you very much for your patience. And thanks again to Pralay for pointing out that mistake.
Time for interaction. Please put forward questions, comments, or suggestions.
So, can I ask?
Yes.
Sripal.
Yes.
If I heard you or saw your slides correctly, the way you mentioned Krishnendu and Ravi Kulkarni's result, it just had the hypothesis that for every n, there are finitely many extensions of degree n.
Yes.
It did not assume perfectness.
I don't know.
I don't know. That's why I'm asking. If that is the case, then in your
I think we assume perfectness. Yeah, I think we assume perfectness.
Okay, so my question would be then, so what happens if the field is not assumed perfect? Are there counterexamples? Or it is just the use of Galois theory which is forcing you to assume perfectness?
Yeah. So it's only the Galois cohomology which forces us to use perfectness. Mm-hmm. But
also in the Jordan decomposition.
Correct.
The simple question would be, so there must be, if it is true or false or perfect.